This is the continuous integration bot. We're going to talk about upstream projects, distributions, what's going on with the CI efforts, what does it mean for you, how you can help, how you get involved. There's some URLs in the slides I have, and I'll try to get the slides up. If not, just remember if you can Google these things and probably find the links. But I think the one that's not all that Googleable is the Fedora Bootstrap project for stage one integration testing. So, you know, what does CI mean? And we, you know, you talk about it, but really it's just, you know, it's that dev practice where you take some of the stuff that you've been working on, you commit it, you integrate it, and the whole purpose of this is to detect those defects before you get to release. And all of that stuff you want to have automated so that it feeds into buzzwords like DevOps, right? So that you know that you know the thing you built is getting tested, and then you just deploy it because you know you built it in a system that was a lot like the thing you were going to test on and the users are going to use. In this bot, we're just going to go through and have some discussions about, you know, which projects are using it, and we can stop and other people can mention. But I'm gonna blow through a few things to let Marek talk about Fedora Mass Rebuild as one of these CI efforts that Marek wants to talk about. So which projects are using CI? So I'll move quickly through this, and then we'll talk more openly amongst all of us about CI. So projects using CI, I am a GNU developer, so I'm looking at GNU first, but the truth is that GDB also has a build bot, it's had it for much longer than us. The GNU compiler collection has actually had a build results set of build bots that are building tons of things for GCC to show that they build, and there's the page for these things. And so what we're getting, I'd say, in the last 5 years is a more concentrated push for the upstream view projects to do CI and to try to do something sensible because, well, the honest truth is that in glibc, at least, we want to accelerate the pace of development, right? We want more work to be done. We don't want to get held back. And much of the reason we get held back is insufficient testing, lack of integration testing, lack of system testing, lack of user tests, you know, and you want to make that story better because the more you do that, the more confidence you have in what you just built, the more confidence you have, the easier it is for you to deploy that thing into the environments you want to use it in. Well, we can come back to this and talk a little more about what other projects might be using CI. Distributions using CI. So I cannot talk about other distributions authoritatively, and I hope that people in this audience can, who are paid maintainers or working at this group, can talk a bit more about what they're doing and passing the mic. Marek's going to talk about the Fedora Mass Rebuilds. I wanted to mention here that in Fedora we're doing a... I'll get to it in just a second, David, and I'll get to it before Marek. We'll switch to the laptops and David can talk. The Fedora Bootstrap is a project that Fedora is getting underway with a set of Bootstrap scripts that basically allows you to crank out the OS build from the bottom all the way to the top, stage 1 through stage 5 Bootstrap. So you can make, instead, for example, a tools change to a stage 1 Bootstrap and then build all the other RPMs for the distro. This is something that I believe Ubuntu and Canonical have had for years now. We're able to do Bootstrap builds from the bottom to the top. I don't know. Is there anyone from Canonical? What?
My impression is OpenSUSE.
Yeah, OpenSUSE as well, because they have the full system builder.
Well, actually, I want to interrupt you, because that's an important distinction between a build service and continuous integration.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the Fedora Bootstrap project is not meant to be a build service. The purpose of the Bootstrap project is to do continuous bootstraps to detect problems with ABIs, APIs, and build issues. So for example, like Jason Merrill's example is like, I didn't change the C++ front end, and it breaks the muscle a bit. But you don't know that until Rawhide sucks in your changes to libs C++. And that has to migrate to the point where the Mozilla builds get done, and that could be 2 months before you see any of that. But with the CI initiative for Fedora Bootstrap, you can have the ability to turn the crank on that all the way through stage 5 if you have a fast enough machine. Mm-hmm. And so you, within a day, see a delta of all the package builds that fell over with the libs C++ change in it. So you tell me, is that, would you consider that CI, or do you consider that a build service that has some CI-like properties that
patch or what, however many you can get through with build, that's, you know, somewhat like a CI versus build service, where you're taking, oh, we're taking official release of all these different packages coming in from everywhere. You got new with SSL, you got the releases, and you're pulling that in, and the machine's automatically calculating all the dependencies and building the universe that way.
I saw that.
If you're being wrong, it's not the releases that are put in. Yeah. We just put it in stuff.
We can talk about this in a minute. So like, we'll come back to the rawhide. I want Marek to give his presentation. So we'll come back and talk about Fedora rawhide, what it means, and we'll come back, David, to your distinction as a boss-like aspect. We'll talk about what is the. I had actually, to be honest, I hadn't thought about build services as SCI at all. Like, I hadn't even considered them, but I know what you mean. There is technically a terminology issue between what's the purpose of the build service versus, and I guess in OpenSUSE, it's a build service, right? It's building you a distro. Can you feed it alternate source RPMs and build into that? Does anyone know?
I don't think, not really. Again, not to distract too much, but the build service is to take in the releases. I mean, I'm not going to lie. OpenSUSE for is to take in the release and to create an actual ISO at the end.
Yeah. No,
But I sort of want to make sure that when we start mentioning OpenSUSE doing this, that they
would be not. Well, I just was downstairs talking to Richard and Michael about what OpenSUSE does, and they do the continuous integration, they do the full system. Just like you talked about, right? They're doing that too.
My understanding is that
GCC rebuilding the whole system, but that's what I thought.
Yeah, they are doing that by saying on every. Release points. It's not a continuous.
No, I think they are.
So I assume they're basically using a lot of the same infrastructure to use service builds to do CI.
Right, which is the case.
Yeah. So the terminology is certainly an issue when you're talking to other people about what you're doing. And in this case, the implementation details happen to be very similar between a build service and a continuous integration service that's doing package builds for you, complete package builds. So within RHEL, we actually have two distinct things. So we have the Fedora Bootstrap that lets you bootstrap from source RPMs. So you would hand it, like you say, buy a different glibc source RPM. That's distinct. Build everything else with it. And then we actually have another internal set of builders that lets you do a little more tweaking, but it's not public yet, but it kind of lets you do inspections of, like, I've changed GCC and a couple other things, and those things are never source RPMs. I'm just going to dump binaries into a root file system, and then you do delta builds of the entire distro set of RPMs and see which RPMs are going to build. So there's one thing that does like this, RPM delta builds to see and actually the tool, the script is smart enough to say, well, it failed with the new tools, but I'm going to rerun it with the old tools. Hey, it worked. That's a regression, right? I mean, mark that. Whereas in Fedora Bootstrap, we don't do that to build with the two distinct tools marked as a regression. You just get to inject at the beginning of stage one and then watch the rollout for the entire distro. And then you look at the high level and say, from the entire distro perspective, what had happened. So it's a bit of a broader picture. And the other sets of tools, for example, are a little more restricted to the to Fedora tools and RHEL tools teams to know core tools changes and how they impact the builds. Just mirror it.
Well,
yeah. And a lot.
Well, at least you see my thing.
Yes, keep changes. You're good. You're done. Ready to go. Now you're done. That's perfect. There you go.
All right. So I've been asked to talk about the Fedora master builds a bit. So let's take it right. Now, I think all of you know what I mean by Fedora master build, but just to be sure. We have got all the Fedora packages. That's all.
Well, no, but he means resources.
I mean, we have just one me in Reddit. But the point is, of course, that that's the GCC. We are looking for ICs, around the global box, and false positives, of course, any trace value codes, and all sorts of various bugs. And on top of that, we also like to test the new features like new optimizations. And when I change to a default for C, and JSON now change to a default for C++, and stuff like that. Now, we do this every year in January or February, and as you know, it's stage 3, which is a regression fixing stage, which is the perfect time to test GCC more. This is a generic overview of the master build. The first step is to rework every package in Fedora using the new GCC. This takes a lot of time, but then we rework the failed builds with old GCC. And this is important so we can ignore the fails that fail with both old and new GCC. And this is the easy part because you just ignore the stuff. Then we need to investigate the failures that only happen with new GCC, which is the hard part and it takes a lot of time because some problems are really hard to analyze.
FTEFS.
What?
FTEFS.
Yeah, it means fail to build from source.
Ah.
Yeah, I tried to be clever so I put that recording there. It is just the package fails to build. That's it. And of course, many bugs are just UV in the code, so you know, the loop stuff and so on. But fortunately, we have UV-sign, but we didn't have UV-sign a few years ago, so it's better these days, but still. Also, many packages have very weird code bases because you need to get familiar with the code base and to, you know, determine how to run a single test. And many packages don't use main but use CMake. I've also been, you know, I have to dig deep in a Haskell code base which uses something completely else. And that sort of gets on my nerves every year because you don't have a single, you know, main file system. And this is the reason why we prefer ISIS or the window files because all you need is grab and maybe reduce some code, which is also usually easy to do, but sometimes you need a LTO filler and these are impossible to reduce, so we tend to ignore them because we spend a week on it, we don't have that time. Also, usually some projects have flaky tests, which means that there are some test failures that only happen on alumni boxes. So when you run a test manually, the failure doesn't show up, but when you run it on alumni box, you know, stuff like that. And also, Ccache comes in play and has all these funky stuff, so I decided to ignore the Ccache altogether for a master build, but that's also not an ideal solution because delays the reboot a bit. Also, many packages are misusing the preprocessor. If you remember the CPPP issue, then that's it. Yeah, and GUM is just a classic because it has all the issues usually every year. I love GUM. Also, the problem is that we have more and more packages. While in 2008 we had like 5,000 packages, in 2015 we had over 16,000 packages. Now, if you combine this number with the fact that I changed the default to GNU 11, which entails overview inline semantics, you can imagine the fun. Now, the result of the master build is usually the porting to HTML document, which helps users to migrate their code bases to GNU GCC. And what follows now is a closer look to how we do this master build. This started a few years ago and this is
what we can ask them.
What?
I see, I think it's cut off something,
right? It is cut off on the right side.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. I can too much.
You can see a file field correctly.
Yeah. then you create a list with the names of these SRPMs, and you split the list into a few portions, like 16 maybe. Another step is to create another repo. This repo are the newly GCC and Libco websites. Then you use some YAML engine and then create repo stuff. Another step is to grab a few info boxes. Usually they take four of them. We set up mark on it and make a change in the configs on every box. Now we have a Druid script which all it does is download the SRPM, record the SRPM in the mark, and save box. Then we run this script four times on each box, so it runs it for a while. And we fill it with the list we created in step one. Now it's just about waiting, and usually this takes days or weeks. Last time it took like 2 weeks just to rebuild one.
So are you doing just like first order? You're just rebuilding each SRPM in isolation, not rebuilding the dependency graph?
Just in one more SRPM in isolation.
Yeah, and their first order is right. Yeah. I spoke to Jeff a lot and Yaku about it. They also use similar scripts. And generally, I asked if someone first order effects that Jeff and Yaku said yes. But it's first order effects to detect low level tool chain. But you can apply the same process and Perl, right? So you can do first order effects of changes in Perl. First order effects.
Oh, right.
Broke something, and I tell you that, I get to revert your patch. We don't often do it because usually we're not that antagonistic. So we work with whomever it is who committed the patch, you discuss it, and you more congenially, you know, make a change and fix the thing.
And I would say the point is not, it's not antagonistic.
Yeah.
Probably experience is not antagonistic, it's just a question of volume.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
So we have a low commit rate in ellipses, so it is, so just fixing things up without reverting is not really slowing people down. Because the Chrome process is quick revert is because the culture is your change not reverted is no skin off your nose, it's just the way it goes.
Yeah.
And that makes and having the tree open for the
other commits that are coming in.
Just simple testing, ultimate solution, usually 4 times.
play, and we're now enforcing across the distro that if you have packages and have cycles in your dev trees, you have to have a bootstrap flag that, for example, disables docs and puts you into a phase where stage one or stage two can progress through the middle of your package. So that, are you doing something similar then?
Yes.
Okay.
So, I think all the testing logs would help with you talk to one in the distance, plus plus AI transition. So because all that would have to have, well, packages built and dependent packages built against these packages. So for this one, we just start the transition and, well, Power farm, the power zone, the power. buildbots right there on the AIX as well. And I have also said I've done buildbots for System Z. So, you know, some of it, there's no single answer. Some of it is when it's a high profile community idea, we'll do this because the community says, well, if you ever want to get your patch, it needs to continue. And some of it is, you know, leading by example. And some of it is the proprietary software that I've been to, which has its equivalent of this, but not a company.
Yeah. I think within Red Hat, obviously, we try to align everything equally across what we do in upstream, what we're doing in Fedora, and what we're doing in RHEL. And some of the RHEL stuff is obviously internal to Red Hat because there are resources and things that we have internal at Red Hat that don't have publicly accessible analogs for all the commercial reasons that you can think of. So from our perspective, I think upstream GLHC for our team has the build bots and build slaves, and when you get to Fedora, it's still public and all the issue becomes more complicated because it's a full distro test. But when we get to RHEL, I'm trying to mention RHEL here. So for RHEL, we do have internal things that include more complicated Jenkins setups and their integration to the Red Hat QE environments that are much more complicated than they are in upstream. And those are just legacy ways in which we do the things that we do. But to be honest, a lot of the results of those things internally, we want to push them upstream. I'll just finish. If you're here for the GLHC bot, one of the biggest questions we have is how do we get the whole system tests that we have internally externally, right? How do we commit them upstream? And the only way to do that is to work on install tree testing upstream to get to the point where upstream has frameworks to do our whole system tests. So you were going to ask a question.
Yeah. As a policy, as a political issue, do you consider the complicated tests and integration, competitive advantage that you don't want to show publicly?
Me personally? So I can speak
so
to
I think the answer is no. We don't consider it's something special.
It's something that we want to do, but it just don't have a plan.
Yeah. They are things that were just complicated steps that we at the time didn't have an upstream community that was receptive or compatible with what we were trying to achieve. So what happens is you end up achieving it internally, and now we're trying to align the community. And it's the whole point of the bots that we're having today is to talk about how can we align things so we can take these whole system tests and just put them upstream. To answer your question, I don't think we have a competitive advantage. So I think there's value for everyone to commit upstream to fixing those things.
As I mentioned before, I think this is a great idea if you go forward for us. My suggestion is that as part of the policy change, that GLHC, GCC, GB, all of these should basically change the definition of GCC calls, primary, secondary, tertiary platforms to say, if you, whatever developer, vendor, whatever, provide the resources, hardware resources, to be able to run this continuous integration tester, you will be considered a first-class platform. And we will make sure that there will not be a release. Once we get to a stable situation, then from that point forward, at least the Python calls are stable. And you will be considered stable, and as long as you provide the resources, we will make sure that reason, not going crazy or hard, we will make sure that all future releases will work in your platform. If you don't do that, it's your hands, we'll take your patches, but you would lose the ability to complain to anyone about things not breaking on your platform.
Speaking for GLHC, agree.
Yeah,
obviously,
agree,
we need to get the infrastructure there.
No, I agree. Yeah.
Puts it in their face.
I agree, yeah. And we discussed this in the point of when you get to a more mature CI infrastructure, you say to the machine maintainers that are being paid by the hardware vendors, you say to them, listen, everyone else has CI builds, and if you don't put your CI build in place, we're not going to care.
Right.
Right? And it's going to build, it's going to break. The only caveat I have with that is that those maintainers need to be responsive. So, you know, for example, you have a lot of smaller tier architectures in GLibC, NIOS 2, microblades, like HPBA is like super legacy, so is Alpha. And so the thing is that like at some point I know Gen 2 is gonna put in an HPBA builder and some other builders, right? And so then it'll be in place, but the problem is if you have a system-wide change that requires that architecture to write something for it not to be broken, there may need to be an exception process that's like, until you fix the system-wide hook that has to get implemented for your architecture, we can't care that your architecture's gone red. Right? And so that's the only caveat I would say to the general policy, but absolutely 100% agree. I agree with Roland that. Yeah, I think that's the way to go forward for that.
So one thing I will add to this is there are a lot of targets which are cross-only. In the blue tool chain. These may not be things that people care about in the GNU code, but these are environmental targets. There is no easy way of testing that in a general.
Well, but your build bot slave can just do the cross build.
It needs to also be able to do a cross test. We need to get to that point. And the various communities need to treat cross compiling also as a first class citizen, not as a tier 2 situation that it is today.
Yeah, so I mean, I can say cross build is first class.
Cross build is first class.
No, cross test is also first class.
It's also, we also have infrastructure for cross test. So, I mean, it's not first class in that it's automatically there on the box. You have to figure out how to.
You, as the cross test maintainer, have to fill in the test wrapper script. And generally, what that wrapper script has to do is sync with an external box. Make sure the file system turns sync, wait for it, and then begin the cross-test process. And that cross-test wrapper is generally ssh-c, blob the command, and the sync file system with the prefix, runs the test, and then gets back the exit code, and that's the exit code reported for the individual test. So we have that cross-infrastructure, people do support it.
It's there, but it's rough around the edges. I haven't looked at it in the last few years, but one of the things there is that there is some work to be done in integrating that into a build bot infrastructure.
Yes.
It isn't as simple as a native integration.
Yes.
That's
so the cross-build process.
The cross-build process is fine. I'm not worried about cross-build.
Yeah, cross-test wrapper.
I used the cross-build process last year.
Alright,
so I use it every day. I don't have
a problem with something like 13 or 14 architectures.
Yeah, Metro graphics and term service are in your hands. Where are you? You're not. What are you doing here? Okay, you guys have filled in cross-test scripts. You know, if you feel like you're able to contribute some of that, that would be greatly appreciated because I know that within your build environments, you have some of this stuff filled out because you do this kind of testing. And the fact that Joseph Myers committed the framework for the test wrapper is because, you know, you guys use it internally. So, you know, my comment to you guys is if it would be possible at all to contribute a skeleton example of, you know, file system sync, followed by wait, followed by run the test in a through SSH to an SSHable box, that would help the community.
Yeah, that has been discussed a number of times already, but there's no consensus yet as to whether that.
Here, I'll let you answer, Luis.
Yeah. It has been discussed a couple of times already, but there's no consensus whether that will happen quickly or not. But my feeling is that if it happens, it will probably happen first for GDP, I guess.
Okay.
Because I think we have most infrastructure like that. And simulator testing, which doesn't quite work well with upstream GDP at the moment. So we have to native GDB server and native GDB and logo remote GDB server testing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'll definitely revive that discussion and see what.
Yeah, I mean, if anything, I think the current GDBC testing is pretty simple. Like,
it sounds simple. It's much more, much simpler than GDBC.
Yeah, it's much simpler than GDBC. But I understand you're saying that your internal needs are to make GDB, to reduce the cost of that internal testing by trying to get as much of it upstream so that other people can also use it, benefit from it, and
whatnot. I think that sounds reasonable.
Okay. Awesome. So if anything, that's the action item for Luis from the BOF is go back to mentor and then be like, you know, people want some kind of skeleton or would be appreciative of a skeleton to show that script implementation.
Well, cross-test Lunaro has all its cross-testing scripts public and available on Git Lunaro.org. And I have a question about this, the new tool chain built for. Do we currently have a dedicated builders for CI in the Google chain new far, or alternatively, do we want to allow automated builds on just general boxes there alongside the developer activities?
No and no.
Do we have and do we want to allow the alternative
both of them? Why this thing?
So how do we use the new, well, I'm not going to call it just a single cloud farm, so it's cool, it's not that. How do we use the new farm to do.
Well, there are no CAD specific systems to do that.
Okay. Yeah. So you want, I mean, I don't know if you or whoever maintains.
No, in a previous discussion that
we had it last year, but I think.
Oh, no, about, I mean, just 2 hours ago. I thought somebody said that that Sergio's GDB built on did have something that's latest running in there.
Yeah, that's all permission. Say it'll be
well, of course, it's by specific arrangement, but for other GNU projects, such arrangement is natural to expect worked out.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
That's different from knowing that.
Well, say you can just assume that because the systems are in the GNU compile form means they can be used.
Yes.
Yeah.
No. Right, I understand. But assume that because it's the GNU cross-farm that we all as GNU participants will cooperate to make this happen. Yes.
Yeah. So the question here is, where do I send the box if I want a particular architecture to be tested with GCC or GOT? Where do I send the box? Do I send it to GNU toolchain farm? Do I send it to Google? Do I just connect it by build box?
Sending a box to an ISP. The vendor will host the box somewhere. Whether you host it in your own facility, whether you buy co-hosting space, software or racks or whatever, or whether you make arrangements with LORAN that have it in the GCC compile farm at the Oregon State University or whatever. But you can do it anywhere. But there's no, it's not the responsibility of the GNUC community or the new toolchain community to take your box and host it for you, period, end of story. No question.
Yeah.
That's not even starting.
Yeah, so the responsibility is inverse. It's, you know, if you have a set of tools that you want to make sure are maintained, you attach your build box to
them. So I think the community is made a for dealing to
you
if this applies across the board. The community takes responsibility for making it easy to plug in your builder to, you know, the community build bot, you know, tracking.
Yeah.
But as far as, sysadmin legwork on the slate, it's
but there
that's
is
part
a,
of what you're contributing.
We do have an expectation that we will revert patches and break your builds, right? So the expectation is you maintain the boxes and we promise not to break the builds on your box, right? You will be looking at the...
Yeah,
the
I mean, everything has things around the margin because, you know, sometimes you can't figure out why it broke. Help figure out the
in some ways it's a similar analog to the micro benchmark and the whole system benchmark testing, and it's Richard Earnshaw here. Well, I know, but my point there is that if the hardware vendor has a workload they're interested in, you know, again, this distributions having builds that they want to work on their systems are contributing that stuff and making sure that it works. Are any other projects doing whole system testing, like PIP? Pedro Luis, do you know if GDB is doing like larger system testing? Like, I'm assuming that your discussions about the infrastructure that you have in GDB testing and cross GDB with GDB server are going to involve some kind of setup process where you have a remote that's running GDB server and a local running GDB, and you run the test and make sure that the two talk to each other, that it works over TCP/IP, that it works over serial. So, can you comment at all about what infrastructure you use for that? Just like VMs or just the native system?
Symbolic labeling sense, but understand that the GNU compile farm is not a
physical hooks the thing where, oh, just, you know, send the system to Laurent and take care of, you know.
No, no,
no, no. Done,
yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. Maybe it's one thing, yeah, yeah. Place of ours is different.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the idea there is to concentrate the place where people go to talk about, okay, what systems do we have,
yeah,
you know, who's hosted them, and can I get a slice of that for my upstream new project to then do better stuff. Yeah. It unifies where everyone's going to talk about the CI issues and the CI infrastructure. Okay, thank you.